Simon & Schuster Audio presents Pearl Harbor, From Infamy to Greatness, by Craig Nelson. Read by George Guidall.
On April 4, 1968, Robert Kennedy was giving a speech in Indiana when he was told that Martin Luther King Jr. had been assassinated. After sharing the news with his shocked and tearful audience, he quoted Aeschylus. "Even in our sleep, pain which cannot forget falls drop by drop upon the heart until, in our own despair, against our will, comes wisdom through the awful grace of God." Preface. Dreadnoughts and Holystones. On February 13, 1940, 13 days before he turned 18, San Antonio High School football player James Lawson volunteered to join the United States Navy. Like everyone else at that moment at the bottom of the barrel in the Department of War, he was paid a princely $21 a month. But getting three hots and a cot was an economic toehold in an America just financially rousing itself from the Great Depression. The services had so slimmed down from their Great War peaks that it was a leap to get in, though civilians commonly looked down on sailors as unsavory ne'er-do-wells, whom they called squids. First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt had made a quip, "The cleanest bodies and the dirtiest minds in the world." While Norfolk, Virginia had signs in its city parks, "Sailors and dogs keep off the grass." After San Diego boot camp, Seaman Second Class Lawson rowed a supply ship across the Pacific, arriving in Oahu at Ford Island's Key Fox 8 in May of 1940. He never forgot crossing the plank for his very first day aboard the USS Arizona, a moment when, so awed by the 30,000-ton dreadnought's grandeur and majesty, he forgot to salute. "I was just overwhelmed by the size of it. New sailors are like that. You go up that gangway for the first time, and you've been trained to ask permission to come aboard and salute the flag at the stern, but the new seamen second come aboard and right away they forget." Lawson's first assignments were brute labor, chipping paint, polishing brass, swabbing, and the most dreaded of all, holystoning. The decks of the ship were planked in teak, and the muscular technique the USN devised to polish them to a sheen was to take a sandstone brick with a hole drilled in it — the bricks originally came from churchly ruins, thus holy stones — and use a broomstick in the hole to soothe the deck. Lawson's bed his first year aboard was a hammock, hung 6 feet in the air so people could walk underneath it, as fellow sailor Galen Ballard remembered. "It rocked nice and put you to sleep, but it was very easy to fall out of. That's a long way to fall." Promoted to mess cook, better to peel potatoes than holy stone decks, Lawson was promoted again after a few months to gunner's mate third class, deck division 4. He lived in the stern, working the port quarterdeck's turret 4, as well as the number 2 catapult, which threw scouts into the sky. The float plane sat on top of the catapult on a cradle, with a long cable that ran along the tracks of the catapult. Usually the plane went off the port side. As the ship turned and faced into the wind, we'd get the word to fire. We'd hit the firing key. It was just like firing a gun. The firing mechanism would fire off that 5-inch cartridge, basically a can full of powder, and when that charge expanded the gas, it fired the plane. It would run on the cradle all the way to the end of the catapult. By the time it hit the catapult, it was at takeoff speed. We had trained to rotate the catapult so that when planes left the ship, they'd be headed into the wind, which was takeoff position for aircraft. When they would come back in, the ship would have to swing around to make a slick. The big ship turning this way or that would flatten out the waves enough for the aircraft to sit down in the water. The plane would taxi up close to where the bosun's mates could swing the crane out to hook onto the plane, to hoist it back aboard and over onto the catapult. In that dawn of radar era, a battle wagon's scout planes sent target coordinates back to her control room, and Lawson, as a pointer, controlled the elevation of his great turret 4 guns, while the trainers ruled their horizontal. Their 179,614-pound cannon could blast 1,400-pound armor-busting projectiles at an angle of 15 degrees for a range of 20 miles, so far that they could pierce the horizon to strike enemies unseen. It was the thrill, pulling the trigger and knowing it was going after somebody across the horizon with another 2,500 to 3,000 pounds of high explosives. Every time I'd press the firing key in that turret and hear those big bullets going shree-oo 20 miles across the water, I was thinking, here's another one for Tojo. That was what the head honchos called the Japanese in those days. We figured that with our superior forces, our superior ships, our superior gunnery, we'd take them. The ship was so huge that it could be depersonalizing. Lawson called everyone guns, since he knew so few of the other men by name, but the Navy knew how to build camaraderie, as North Carolina's John Rampley explained. A man's name was presented by the senior petty officer to the whole gun crew. If any of them didn't like him or thought that he would be incompatible, he didn't get in. So if you did make it, you felt you were part of a select group. Clint Westbrook, originally from the Bronx, was one of the powder men working with Lawson at Turret 4, using hoists to transfer 60-pound powder bags and shells up from the magazine deep below, across the scuttle of the fireproof hatch, and then up to the turret. Westbrook assumed that the war was near, but that it would strike not in their Pacific, but in the Atlantic. "I signed up for a 6-year peacetime stint," he said. Lawson eventually qualified as a helmsman, taking wheel watch on alternate days, meeting the boss, Captain Franklin von Valkenburg, and working the ship's three methods of steering: electric, steam, auxiliary, to make sure she was ready for anything. Auxiliary meant brute muscle force, a tag team of crew using their full body weight against enormous cranks. He'd run down a long hallway and grab one of those big spokes and ride that sucker down. Somebody'd go right behind you and ride the next one down. It was a constant run, one man at a time. But besides that method of power and the dreaded holystoning, Lawson loved his life at sea, especially serving on a battleship. We were kingpins in the Navy in those days. We looked down on the destroyer sailors. It was like living in a big city. The Arizona's keel was laid at the Brooklyn Navy Yard in New York City on March 16, 1914, when she was then known only as Number 39. The keel is the spine of a ship's hull, which, like a human spine, serves as the structural foundation, the vessel's backbone. Laying the keel places that spine in the cradle where the ship will be constructed around it, and is the official moment of birth. Since Number 39, with her sister ship Pennsylvania, would be the biggest fighting ship built or building for any Navy, according to the New York Times, the ceremony of laying the keel was postponed until 11 o'clock yesterday morning in order to make possible the presence of Assistant Secretary Roosevelt in a greatcoat, bowler hat, and gold pince-nez. The firing of a salute of 17 guns from the Super Dreadnought North Dakota announced his coming. Then, the giant traveling crane above the cradle of the battleship-to-be began to move. It carried a massive steel plate and dropped it at the spot designated by the constructors. Then Mr. Roosevelt stepped forward. Captain Cleves handed him a silver-plated bolt. Mr. Roosevelt quickly hammered it into place while the band played the national anthem and the crowd stood with bared heads. Through his mother, Sarah, Assistant Secretary of the Navy Franklin Delano Roosevelt was descended from a family that had made its fortune in seafaring, his grandfather, Warren Delano, having prospered in the trade of Chinese tea and opium. Franklin, as a teenager, learned to sail the Hudson River aboard the family's 60-foot schooner Half Moon, and at the age of 5, he accompanied his influential father, who had made a great fortune in rail and coal, to the White House, where President Grover Cleveland told the boy, "My little man, I am making a strange wish for you. It is that you may never be President of the United States." As a New York State Senator, Franklin publicly campaigned for Woodrow Wilson against his fifth cousin, Teddy. When Wilson won, he appointed FDR Assistant Secretary of the Navy in 1913, and Roosevelt would have this job when, on April 6, 1917, America joined the Great War. He nagged Navy Secretary Josephus Daniels to grant him a commission, but was turned down because Daniels judged Roosevelt's administrative duties, overseeing procurement and shipping, as too important. FDR would forever after love the United States Navy with an unimaginable passion. During his presidency, he personally selected the service's flag officers raised its budget every year, and called the Navy us, and the Army them, until General George Marshall insisted he stop. At his White House breakfast meetings, the nation's chief executive often sat in bed, his shoulders draped in a blue Navy cape, surrounded by his collections of postage stamps and naval memorabilia. Admiral Ernest King, chief of naval operations after Pearl Harbor, remembered a visit to the cruiser Houston on the afternoon of February 28, 1939. Roosevelt was in high spirits, for he loved the Navy and always visibly expanded when at sea. As the admirals greeted him, he would have some pleasant, half-teasing, personal message for each. During FDR's tenure with the Navy in World War I, Winston Churchill was Great Britain's first Lord of the Admiralty, and Roosevelt saw their careers as taking similar paths. Eventually, he wrote to Churchill in 1939 that, "You should keep me in touch personally about anything you want me to know about." When Joseph Kennedy, ambassador to England, asked about their relationship, FDR said, "I have always disliked him since the time I went to England in 1918. He acted like a stinker at a dinner, lording it all over us. I'm giving him attention now because there is a strong possibility that he will become the Prime Minister, and I want to get my hand in now." Cabinet member Francis Perkins called Roosevelt the most complicated human being I ever knew. On August 10, 1921, Roosevelt was on vacation with his family at Campobello, his father's island estate off the New Brunswick coast. FDR and his sons were out sailing when they spotted a fire in the woods and docked to help put it out. At dinner that night, Roosevelt didn't feel well and went to bed early. In the morning, he found he could barely walk. By that night, his back and legs were racked with pain, his temperature had soared to 102 degrees, and eventually he was diagnosed with poliomyelitis and was paralyzed from the waist down. He now had to be carried by attendants up and down stairs, had a Ford convertible modified so it could be driven entirely by hand, and on being elected governor of New York in 1928 and president of the United States in 1932, developed a gentleman's agreement with the press, especially the photographers, for him not to be seen as helpless. He had trained himself to appear to walk in public through a remarkable feat. Holding onto a cane with one hand and the arm of an aide or a son with the other, he would tilt his useless legs, held rigid by steel braces, from side to side, inching forward like an acrobat on the parallel bars, powered entirely by his arms and shoulders. It was such an incredible performance that few Americans ever knew.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.